Green River was a tighter, more disciplined album from before. There was less obvious aimless jamming there, so it was maybe more tightly organised. But I think John Fogerty was getting more aware of production techniques. That's not to say that it was overproduced in any way, far from it, but I think it was more disciplined, and the fact that it was a number one album with two number two singles, and we're talking about America here, which were big, big sales, shows that the fans certainly were ready for more.
We were recording as fast as John wrote the songs. I think John was afraid that we would, you know, if we didn't always have a single on the charts, we would just disappear.
The Corner was from Willie and the Poor Boys, and actually this is another example of Creedence Clearwater moving on to a slightly different feel, away from the bayou and maybe towards the Caribbean.
That was a very tough song for us to record because we just kept wanting to speed it up and speed it up, and it had to have that, you know, a bit of a laid back, off the beat feel, and we'd never played a song like that. And in fact, we might have said, hey John, this isn't rock and roll. You know, we might have been resistant.
Yes, perhaps this is a little bit more funky, but it's not James Brown, and it's not Sly Stone. It feels more poppy than funky. People just got a smile.
The album that it's taken from, it just conjures up that image of guys that are willing to play for a few nickels and just go out and busk. It's about a bunch of buskers, basically, if you think about it.
Blue collar, working man, pop, rock, CCR. It hits a nerve and hits the nail on the head.
And that song, again, another hook. Da, 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 da. You know, bass and guitar throughout the whole song, really. You know, then the rhythm.
Great rhythm section work on this. It's a shuffling, almost a Latin samba beat to it. One of those grooves that not many rock bands have ever explored, and yet it still sounds timeless today.
That's what really made songs like Down on the Corner and that sort of the hallmarks of what the CCR sound was evolving into, sort of more from the swamp rock sounds of their first two albums. And again, you see a whole set of new influences start coming into their music at that point.
Some people think of rock bands as being outside the political spectrum, or they should stay outside the political spectrum. And others, you know, applaud when the U2s and CCRs, you know, thinking of Fortunate Son, come to the party and express their political views. And I'm all for it. Did they stray too far from being a straight-ahead rock and roll band that sounded like they were out of the South? Probably not. I mean, Fortunate Son seems to be the only track anybody ever refers to in context of CCR being political.
I want people to know when I'm really saying something seriously and when I'm just being an entertainer, you know. But it's also important that then I don't appeal to basic motivations, that I don't start, you know, hey, all you hippies, join together and let's smoke dope, you know. I mean, people are going to dig that, a certain element of society, but I don't want them digging it for that. I want them to look a little further than just, hey, okay, we're all together, brother, you know, and that crap. I tried to stay away from, hey, he's a left-wing radical crazy, or he's a super bircher, you know, because both sides can take it, you know, and use it as their own rallying cry. Same as Fortunate Son, really. You know, you can see all the Minutemen, the Birchers saying, wow, the Fortunate Son, yeah, I hate them people too.
Yeah. at the time, I think music was more important to the whole political debate. You know, the era was rife with political dissent, you know, the Vietnam War, and just a whole lot of social changes going on. And the song spoke to the inequities in who was actually doing the fighting and the dying, and who was not doing the fighting and the dying.
Fortunate Sons still sounds very angry when you listen to it now. It's John Fogerty suddenly going off at a tangent.
Basically, he'd seen on television Pat Nixon or some of the Nixon kids, and he was thinking, like, you know, these are American kids the same age as me, yet they're never going to go to Vietnam, you know? And I think that's where he wrote that, you know, people that are high up in government, they don't want to send their kids off to a war, but they're willing to pass bills to send other parents' kids off to war.
A great menacing sound. It's actually played with guitar A shapes, but they're detuned a tone, and they were very fond of detuning the guitars to get this great driving dark sound.
One of three anti-war tracks on that album, Right Place, Right Time. Again, he summed it up in simple words. And it worked.
We were all quite political. You know, John and Doug both were in the armed forces and had to fight their way out so we could even have the band. Finally, they were both discharged, and we proceeded, but we continued our strong opposition to the war. But at the same time, you know, you have to support the guys doing the fighting. You know, they didn't pick the war.
You hear the work bell ring, and I march you to the table. You see the same old thing.
Midnight Special from Willie and the Poor Boys album is a highlight, definitely. It's a lead belly song, and I think once again, they really enjoyed doing it. They enjoyed playing it. They stretched out a little bit on it, in as far as they would like to stretch out.
Let the midnight special shine a light on. Definitely CCR were experimental, because they would take a lot of songs from the 50s, like the Midnight Special, for instance, and change it, and make it sort of a more of a product of their times. Instead of just basically copying the sound, they add a lot to it. Let the midnight special shine an
ever-loving light on me. Yonder come Miss Rosie. The gospel tune that we, you know, attempted to rock a little bit, but I think the multi-part harmonies that John is singing on the track really add sort of that gospel southern, you know, church thing to it almost, and it's an interesting arrangement. Actually, when I think of that song, I really don't think of anybody else's arrangement of it but Creedence.
Personally, I found it a bit plodding and a bit remedial, and you know, I applaud their simplicity on one hand, but that song just doesn't do it for me.
Again, the detuned guitar down a tone, this lovely gospel kind of vibe to it, and the way it meanders from a shuffle into a straight feel and then back into a shuffle later on. One of the best ever vocals from Fogerty on this song.
Well, John Fogerty had this marvelous knack of combining playing guitar and singing, and not exactly at the same time. It's a great folk tradition or blues tradition that you sort of answer yourself. You play a phrase and then answer back to it. But no, he had a very mature, smoky, powerful voice.
He had that certain sound that was developed after album after album. It's not really a screaming sound, but it was a growl, and it was so distinct and so unique. It was CCR.
He never shouted, yet he was always very commanding in the way he sang to you.
Yeah, that's why the black audiences loved him so much. Incredibly soulful. He was obviously greatly influenced by Little Richard. But amazing power and range.
And his lyrics and his melodies were really very memorable and very simple.
In terms of style and passion and grit and intensity, it's hard to find someone who had more than John Fogerty in the context of what they were doing as a band.
I think Willie and the Poor Boys was in a lot of ways probably the pinnacle, when you consider that afterwards Cosmos Factory and then the albums that followed that seemed to sort of be the band was maturing to the point where there's other issues involved with the members wanting to do their own thing maybe and stuff like that.
This was a number three album in the States, Willie and the Poor Boys, and it's probably about as good as it gets in terms of a feel-good rock album. The sleeve says it all. They're standing there with a chest bass and a washboard and everything else, which they actually used, I believe, on Poor Man Shuffle. And it works. It works a treat.